May 26, 2015, and the city council is now in session. As a reminder, if you do speak, state your name for the record. We had minutes on the common council, April 24th and May 12th. Did anybody have any corrections or additions? If not, we'll make a motion to approve them as printed.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Okay, we had a Board of Public Works and Safety, April 16th and 30th. Does anybody have any questions or comments on minutes of the Board of Public Works and Safety? Okay, let's move on to communications. Does anybody have anything for communications? Okay, we have a public hearing for the reestablishment of the Community Capital Development Fund.
Correct. That one is just reestablishing the rate from 0.0381 back up to 0.05.
Did we do this before?
We did. We started last year and it got filed to the DLGF one day late. So okay. They couldn't follow through with it.
So you have paperwork on that to
yes.
Open the. Does everybody have any of that or do we need that here?
Is that 6/2015?
6/2015, yes.
Michelle, is this the same rate, if I remember right?
Correct, yes. It actually dropped again. Last year it was 0.0388, so it dropped to 0.0381.
So we'll open the public hearing up for this resolution. Is there any questions on the council's side here? Okay, I'll entertain a motion to read resolution 6-2015. Brian, would you like to read it? Oh, yeah. We need a motion from Brian to read it for the public hearing.
Make a motion for the reading of resolution 6-2015. Let that alone then.
Second. Don't want to do it in the tires. Just do it one time for public comment.
Okay, I can amend by motion.
Probably should read it in its entirety since it's a public hearing. That's my recommendation. It's not that long.
I'll amend my motion then. In full.
Second. All in favor? Resolution number 06-2015, an ordinance reestablishing the City of Rochester Cumulative Capital Development Fund. Whereas the City of Rochester, Fulton County, Indiana, accepted and passed ordinance 072005, establishing the Cumulative Capital Development Fund under Indiana Code 36-9-15.5, and whereas Indiana Code 36-9-15.5 allows municipalities to establish and continue a cumulative capital development fund, and whereas the City of Rochester finds that such a fund is necessary and prudent for the financial well-being of the municipality, and whereas the tax rate and levy has been adjusted through the years and currently is 0.0381 per $100 of assessed value, with the allowable rate being 0.05 per 100 of assessed value. And now, therefore, be it resolved by the Common Council of the City of Rochester, Fulton County, Indiana, as follows. 1. That the City of Rochester hereby reestablishes the Cumulative Capital Development Fund beginning in the year 2016. The maximum rate of levy will not exceed 0.05 per 100 of assessed valuation each year. The funds accumulated in the City of Rochester Cumulative Capital Development Fund will be used for all uses as set out in IC 36-9-15.5. Notwithstanding Section 3 of this ordinance, funds accumulated in the Cumulative Capital Development Fund may be spent for purposes other than the purposes stated in Section 3. If the purpose is to protect the public health, welfare, or safety in an emergency situation which demands immediate action, money may be spent under the authority of this section only after the mayor issues a declaration that the public health, welfare, or safety is an immediate danger that requires expenditure of money in the fund. This fund takes effect upon approval of the Department of Local Government Finance. Okay, do I have any questions from the council? Okay, I'll pass it out to the audience. Is there any questions to the audience for the public hearing? If not, Andy, do we need to vote on this before we close the public hearing, or close it first and then vote on it?
I think your vote is part.
Okay. All in favor for the city council members to adopt Resolution 6-2015 to reestablish the Community Capital Development Fund? All in favor?
Or we need a motion?
Oh, yeah. I'd make a motion for the adoption of Resolution Number 6-2015.
I'll second.
Any discussion? All in favor of the adoption of 6-2015? Opposed? Okay, 6-1. Now we'll close the public hearing.
Well, as part of the public hearing, we also have the ordinance 9-2015 established.
We're gonna reopen that.
For the second one?
Yeah. So now we'll open the public hearing for ordinance 9-2015, establishing Community Fire Fund. So the public hearing is open for that. You have that here. Is it okay, you want to explain this, Shawna?
What this is, is in the general fund currently, the fire department budgets $50,000 a year for equipment purchases, truck purchases, which is, if it doesn't get spent, they lose that appropriation every year. So what this fund does is it actually shifts that $50,000, actually it'd be slightly more than $50,000, because I couldn't come up with an exact rate for $50,000 on this. So it'll shift it from the general fund over to a cumulative fund that will actually accumulate and stay within that. So it's a non-reverting fund for the fire department. So obviously their equipment is much more expensive to replace, and this allows them the opportunity to accumulate those funds separate from using general or LOIT and capital development funds.
Hasn't there always...
Something the chief and I have talked about, I'm sorry?
Hasn't there always been that fund?
No.
In the fire department for equipment?
It's in the budget.
It's in the budget.
It's in the budget.
That's what I'm saying.
Right, no.
It's been in the budget before.
Yeah, if they don't spend it, it goes away.
Correct. This allows it to accumulate, so he could, so the fire department could accumulate cash on hand rather than only $50,000 per year. So as far as an effect on taxes, it's a lateral shift. There's no effect on taxes, because we're just moving it from general to the cumulative. And the chief had asked me a couple of years ago about it, so we had done some research, and that's, he felt that was fair to leave it at that 50.
Basically, chief, you might want to elaborate on that.
Yeah, I've had it in the budget for, well, 7 years, trying to get this passed, because, I mean, one thing, when we first came up for the first purchase, it was like, where are the funds? How are we going to plan for this? So this is, I mean, like I said, it allows us to build within our planning, so you can actually do a four-year plan. I'm going to have X amount of dollars in this fund to execute a cash transaction instead of a lease payment or anything like that, so you can get a trucks on rotation. That's one of the things. We're in a good spot now, but in the past, we haven't been in a spot where a lot of the trucks need to replace because they're in such age and just outdated. Now we've got a good fleet. We could manage it with the appropriate funds and actually rotate where they have some value, instead of waiting until we have scrap value for our equipment or replacing it. So trying to keep up to date, less maintenance, things like that, long-term expenditures, but just so you can actually have a plan, and you know, I've got this money sitting here. If I don't use it this year, I have that much more next year. Or in the past, you know, with LOIT or some of the other ways we've accumulated equipment, this just a set way. It's what was asked actually the council before I became a councilman to come up with a plan, and this was the plan. It's just taken 6 years to get it on paper.
Shawna, how will this work? come budget time. Will we still budget $50,000 under the fire department, or will we just budget it straight for?
Correct. This will be a fund that will be established, and we will, that will be set into this fund as opposed to in the general fund. So that line item for the fire department would either decrease if you wanted to put it in there for other purposes, or just eliminate it altogether. That would be a discussion, you know, what the chief proposes to you.
So.
It's just a lateral move if we go into this fund.
If we create this fund, can we transfer this year's money into this fund at the end of the year, whatever's left?
We could. That will require some other steps, and there's a cutoff limit to doing that type of transfer, and I'll have to check with the DLGF. Because what you're, are you thinking of going ahead and starting it with the $50,000 right out of the gate?
Well, I just thought if we created it this year, and I don't know what chief has had to spend out of that line item at the end of the year, if there was an opportunity to transfer and keep that money.
I could double check on that. Off the top of my head, I'm going to say maybe, but I will double check with the DLGF on it.
If not, it can transfer into the rainy day fund and then take the council to reappropriate it. So, but. Anybody else have any questions on it? Okay, does any of the public have any questions? Okay, I will entertain a motion to read ordinance number 9-2015 for the.
I'll make a motion we have the first reading of ordinance 9-2015 in full.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor? Okay. Ordinance number 09-2015, an ordinance establishing the City of Rochester Cumulative Fire Fund. Under Indiana Code 6-1.1-41, be it resolved by the City of Rochester Common Council of Fulton County, Indiana, that a need now exists for the establishment of a cumulative fire fund for the following purposes. For all uses as set out in IC 36-8-14, be it further resolved that this council will adhere to the provisions of Indiana Code 6-1.1-41. The proposed fund will not exceed 0.02 on each 100 of assessed valuation. Said tax rate will be levied beginning with the taxes for 2015 payable 2016. Be it further resolved that proofs of publication of the public hearing held on the 26th day of May 2015 and a certified copy of this ordinance shall be submitted to the Department of Local Government Finance of the State of Indiana as provided by law. This cumulative fund is subject to the approval of the Department of Local Government Finance. I'll entertain a motion for the second reading of ordinance number 9-2015.
Make a motion to have the second reading of ordinance number 9-2015 by title only.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Okay.
Ordinance number 9-2015, an ordinance establishing the City of Rochester Cumulative Fire Fund under Indiana Code 6-1.1-41. I'll entertain a motion to have a third reading by title only.
So moved.
Have a second?
Second.
All in favor? All opposed?
Ordinance number 09-2015, an ordinance establishing the City of Rochester Cumulative Fire Fund under Indiana Code 6-1.1-41.
Question.
Okay.
To suspend the rules for the third reading, if we have someone opposed, can we go ahead with the third reading? It's got to be unanimous.
You had unanimous, doesn't it? To pass.
It has to be unanimous to proceed with the third reading.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll push the third reading to that.
Right. Okay, so it'll be on the agenda for next meeting to have a third reading.
Does that also have to be a public hearing meeting for the third reading? For the fact that we discussed the first two readings on our public hearing?
No, the public hearing was met with the publication, the opportunity to speak. I don't think the third reading is on public because it's already been introduced.
We're going to miss our suspense.
That's the objection to the third reading.
Okay.
I mean, you could, a member of council can consent to the third reading and still vote against the proposal.
Yeah, but if they vote against suspending the rules and having.
Correct.
Okay, so then there's no other comment to the public. We'll go ahead and close the public hearing for ordinance 9-2015. Okay, Chief Butler, do you have a report for the council?
For the month of April, structure fires, one in the city, two in Rochester Township, one in Newcastle Township. Grass fires, four in Rochester Township, one in Newcastle Township. Auto fire alarms, one in the city. Mutual aid, one in Argus Fire, one in Mentone Fire, one in Liberty Township. Calls for smoke, two in the city. Accidents, one in the city, two in Rochester Township. Medical assist, nine in the city, two in Rochester Township, one in Newcastle Township. Drove the ambulance back to the hospital one time. Called for a lift assist one time in the city. Had a total of 31 runs and one drill.
Thank you, Chief. Any questions for Chief Butler? Now we'll move to Chief Schatz, police chief.
For the month of April, there were a total of 16 accidents. 119 total warnings were issued. Seven of those were city ordinance warnings. We have been doing a lot of city ordinance warnings for grass and weeds this month. So if you have any in your neighborhoods that we don't get to, let us know, because obviously we can't see all of them. So if you have any issues, let me know. There were 165 total offenses with 123 traffic, 38 criminal, and four juvenile. 48 total case reports drawn, 809 calls for service, 34 lockouts, nine vehicles towed, and 18 people incarcerated. I did not get a chance to do the list of offenses people were lodged for. I'll have that for you next meeting, next month. That is that. Do you guys have any questions on the numbers?
What do you attribute the significant increase to traffic offenses?
Operation Pullover. We've had...
Did we just go through that?
We're going through one now, and there was one last month, Operation Pullover.
Was that mostly seatbelt?
It was strictly seatbelt enforcement, and so was this one. I can try to find the date, but yeah, right now we're currently under Operation Pullover. We've got three guys participating. And it's not mandatory. I don't know if you're familiar with Operation Pullover. It's not mandatory for the officers to do it. It's strictly on a voluntary basis. And it goes until the end of the month. And then, yeah, we had Operation Pullover last month as well. I'm trying to find the dates. Yeah, April 5th to April 25th, we participated in, and they were strictly seatbelt enforcement. And in fact, last month it was a RDP grant, a rural demonstration project where it's seatbelt enforcement in rural areas. So if you may have seen or heard that we had some guys running traffic on 31, that's not the case, but it may have looked like it because they might have been sitting on like 6th Street or 13th Street, watching vehicles come on and off of 31. So
I did hear that. So that was my next question.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So we're not patrolling.
No, we don't patrol 31. No. The grant for the RDP, the Rural Demonstration Project, was rural seatbelt enforcement. So it was strictly rural areas. And not everyone, I know the Sheriff's Department participated in it, and they received the grant. It's under Operation Pullover, but not. It's the same thing, only different. In fact, the funds, yeah, this time it didn't, it said, didn't the check from the state, it didn't say Rural Demonstration
rural
Project.
Rural Demonstration Project, and I had to call it because I had no idea what Rural Demonstration Project was.
It's strictly rural seatbelt enforcement. And that's what this one is too, so that we're participating in now.
Okay.
And then, yeah, June 13th, we've got the triathlon coming up. We're going to be busy with that. It's going to be a busy day. Probably going to call the state police, see if they can get some guys to come and help, the sheriff's department to come and help. We are going to be short-staffed again this summer, like we were last year. We've already lost one officer. He resigned. May 8th, he resigned. We've got another officer that is going through the hiring process for the state police, and he's already been given a conditional offer. So his last day, I think, is June 25th, so long as everything goes okay. He went down last week to public safety medical for the psychological evaluation and medical testing. As long as that goes okay, then he's going to be given an invitation to their academy, which starts at the end of June. And he's already planning on that. That's almost a sure thing. He's going to be using up his days next month. So he'll work, I think, 2 or 3 days at the beginning of the month, and then he'll work the 25th, which will be his last day. And then we've got two in the academy right now. So slim pickings. They get back July 10th, so if we can make it to that, would be okay.
Neither one of the officers that have resigned are going to resign and have been through the academy?
Yes.
They have?
Both.
How long have they been on?
2.5 years, one, and another was Jesse, probably 4 years, 4 or 5 years.
Okay.
His brother's a state trooper. What?
Four for Jesse.
Was it four? I'm not sure, 4 or 5.
I believe he was hired in 2012.
So they were on staff long enough to not have to reimburse the city for academy costs?
Yeah.
That's where I was concerned.
And there are no costs for the academy. I don't think we can make them pay their wages back, can we?
We do now.
It didn't apply to those two.
It did anyway.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So we did it once. I suppose we'll do it again. I don't know what the solution is. I don't want to be a training ground for other departments, but and I don't know. I don't know what the answer is. Maybe I'm running them off. I hope that's not the case, but you never know. So that's about all I have right now, unless you have any questions.
What's that? Thank you, Chief Shots. Any questions?
No, thanks, Brad.
Okay.
Thanks.
Let's move down here to new business to expedite a few things here. I know Terry Lee and Diane Spores here, so unless you want to stay for the whole meeting, but you can bounce down here. Shadi, you're on your new business, city election expenses. Do you want to talk about that?
Yes. Last year during the budget process, it was overlooked to make sure that we put in our general fund, the line item, to reimburse the county for our city election expenses. And I received the bill for the primary election, which was almost $11,000. $10,147.57, of which I was able to take care of that one. However, the next one coming for the general election, I'm not going to be able to easily flip that $20,000 to $25,000 bill. So we need to figure out if we want to do an additional appropriation to the council budget, if you want to look at alternative funding. I will say that we will have some additional appropriation available out of the rainy day fund, because the bond that I'm paying off early, actually I won't need to utilize the entire amount that we did the additional appropriation for out of the rainy day fund. So I could use that and then reimburse from the general fund back up into the rainy day fund, like we talked about doing for the payoff of that general obligation bond. So I just need to have some thoughts from you guys on how you want me to move forward with looking at this, the last city election, the general election, and mind you, the other change in this is we no longer share elections with the towns. Akron and Kiwanis both opted to change their election schedule over to, I think it fits with the county elections now. So they changed up their term limit, so they went to a three-year term for 1 year, and then they'll be back on a four-year term in order to adjust. It was something the state allowed them to do a year or two ago, and they opted to do that. So the city is the only one on the ballots for this election. And in 2011, the general election cost was roughly $10,400, but again, that was a shared expense with the towns. So when I was speaking to Judy, we kind of, and Terry Furnival, obviously we won't be able to tell exactly how much it's going to cost us, but they told me to make sure that I doubled that, because the primary election the year before was $4,120, and we went from that to $10,000. So I would rather err on the side of caution. So I just need an idea of what direction. I mean, we've got till November, so I just need to know what direction you guys would like me to look at going to fund it.
I'd say take it out of the rainy day fund, because if you don't, you're going to shorten the other budgets. You know, it's, you know, harsh enough remarks down. That's not an option for the project, Team Pride project.
It doesn't look like it now.
Okay.
Why was the increase from 4,000 to 10,000 on a primary?
Well, because last year's primary, the only contested race in the city was District 2.
Yeah.
And that was it. This year we had the mayoral and District 3.
Yeah.
So,
and
plus.
That went from 4,000 to $10,000.
Mm-hmm. Plus, we didn't, and again, it was just the city. We didn't share any expenses of county poll workers with any of the towns.
So that 4,000 was part of a shared expense?
Correct.
Correct. 10,000 was just all
so part. How do we share? I mean, because we're paying for our precincts, they're paying for their precincts. I don't understand how they share expenses.
There's some technology costs that is a large amount of that for the voting machines
okay.
and stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
I would mention that the last meeting we approved the 30 for the asbestos removal at Hartshefner Marks. Doesn't look like that project's going to go, so we could slide that money over to cover this cost.
Yes, we could.
I don't think we reappropriated anything for that yet.
No,
we just talked about it. And we approved it if the need came up.
Is that in favor of rainy day?
It's not our only option. Got to run the city on the rest of the budgets.
So rainy day or riverboat, right?
Nah, it's got a rainy day.
I mean, you can do an additional appropriation for the general fund, but that requires DLGF approval, just right. Like we did with the rainy day fund. So, I mean, you're talking, it'd be probably 2 months by the time we get, you guys approve, we advertise it, you approve it, and then I send it to the DLGF and get back. So we got time, it's just, if you'd rather do it the easy way, do it easier, do the rainy day, and then we just reimburse the rainy day back towards the end of the year.
I'll entertain a motion to take it out of rainy day. Get it started.
I make a motion that we pay for the city expense for the election out of rainy day.
Okay. I'll second.
All in favor?
And that was Marty's second.
Okay. Takes care of that one. Carrie Lee, glad to have your presence.
Thank you. Always I hear that. Okay, so for last fall, the top industries tax abatement, last fall we met and talked about a possible upcoming expansion of top industries out on State Road 25. They manufacture sewage basins and pumps and systems, and they were just getting some things together over the winter. Looks like they want to consider proceeding with an expansion for mostly a warehouse space, about 100,000 square feet, help them retain 61, I think, jobs and add probably 15 at around 12 bucks an hour, looks like right now. So tonight we need to just accept the declaratory resolution establishing the economic revitalization area, which you should also have a map that just shows basically all the top industry owned property over 25. So we'll just need to, I guess, read Andy and move to accept the declaratory resolution that establishes that area as the ERA, and then setting the public hearing, which would be, I assume, it would work out to be at your next council meeting on July 23rd, maybe?
June.
What did I say, July? June? Yeah.
If it's the next one.
June 22nd.
Okay.
No, 23rd, excuse me.
Okay, at least I had the date right. That makes me feel better.
23rd,
yeah, so set that for June 23rd, and the SB1 and the forms to all, that'll give me time to advertise the public hearing and get the forms out to all the taxing units. The Redevelopment Commission met on Friday and discussed it, and they approved forwarding it to the City Council for your consideration. You know, the option, I guess, for those guys that they considered was they have a space in Argus. They'd like to keep it here. They have property at either place. They'd like to keep it here. He says running two is kind of nightmarish, so he's hoping to be able to do it here. So, any questions?
I just had a question on the map, Terry.
Mm-hmm.
Is this part of where Olympic
yes.
was, that's not included? Is that because it goes residential here, or?
Which piece?
Adams. I mean Adams sale.
Yep.
But yeah, this was the original.
The office was.
Yeah, they retained that and sold this property.
Okay. So that's why it
yeah, that's why
doesn't
it drag it.
Come
yeah,
here.
Correct. Yeah, they still retain ownership of that when they okay. did the transaction.
Sorry.
No, we're good. Is that good?
So, yeah.
Okay.
Are you wanting us to pass the resolution tonight?
Right.
To move forward for the public hearing?
Right. Correct? Yeah.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to read the passage. Declaratory resolution number 9-2015 for the economic revitalization area. Is it more or less a bunch of legal verbiage? I'll take it. Entertain a motion to read it how you want to do it.
Is gerbage like a cross between verbiage and garbage?
I didn't say that.
I'd make a motion for the reading of resolution 9-2015 by title only.
Second. All in favor? Okay. Declaratory resolution number 09-2015, resolution designating a portion of the city of Rochester, Indiana as an economic revitalization area.
And all this does, Terry, is allow that area to
be designated
for tax abatement.
Yep.
Because right now it's not.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah, I have to come back up the next meeting for a public hearing. Right. But if there's another question, I'll entertain a motion to pass the declaratory resolution 9-2015.
Mark, one of the things that we talked about at that meeting last fall was that question of getting a, you know, establishing a larger area, just all in one, just kind of veiling an area.
Is that when we were doing the American Axle?
Yeah. Yeah. And I thought through that a little bit, and if we did it that way, then the first time you guys would necessarily see it then would be at the public hearing. You would just have a public hearing appear on your agenda, and that would be really the first discussion of it. So, you know, we have a process that is working, I think, with, you know, you always get to the point that the guy is kind of ready to go, and maybe we have to wait 30 days, so that's the other side of the scale, but this seems to work out okay, and I can typically cover everything between meetings that we have and conversations I'm having with the company to make sure they know what's going on. and that things are going to work through in a timely fashion, and they're okay with that too, because these projects take months, you know, to come together. They just know this is part of the process early on, so they can plan for it, I guess, would be my recommendation, to just kind of plug along at this pace, you know, project specific, unless you guys want to do it different.
I don't know where we're at. Did we have a motion yet?
So moved.
We need to have a second. All in favor, pass.
Somebody did second that?
I did.
Oh, okay.
Brian, the motion, I second.
All in favor for the passage of 9-2015? Opposed? 7-0. Okay, passes.
Thank you.
Okay, Diane, you're up. Come on down.
She's been so patient with us tonight.
Thank you for the opportunity to be here. Actually, what I'm doing tonight is just, I'm here on an informative basis, just to give you guys a courtesy, because I know you'll be faced with questions, but you know, last year the chamber did make the decision to forego sponsoring the Round Barn Festival in the community. So I wanted to let you know what direction we're going this year. Some of you have heard this already. But we're really going to start advertising, and I just wanted you to be aware. This year, we're looking at having a community celebration. It will no longer be in June. We've moved it to July 10th and 11th, and the reason for that was the Indiana State Festivals Association is encouraging towns and communities with smaller events to couple those events, partner them together, and try to create an atmosphere where there's something going on the entire weekend, which then may draw in people from, you know, outside of that hour drive, because if they come in and there's several activities they can attend over a two-day period, they may stay in your hotels, which would put them at your gas stations and at your restaurants and in your shops. So that's kind of the direction we're going. The Lake Manitow Association has their weekend where they do the boat tours and everything, so that's why we chose that weekend to partner with them. So we're looking at having a parade. What we did was we looked at the best parts of the Round Barn Festival and wanted to keep them and incorporate them into this event. And the community was adamant about having a parade still, so we're having that on July 10th at 6:30. I spoke with Andy a while back about the possible parade route. Instead of turning on 9th Street, we'd like to bring it straight downtown and end it between 6th and 7th, keeping 6th open so we have that access to 31. That will make our stores and restaurants in the downtown area very happy, because we're putting people right in their front doorsteps, and then we're encouraging them to get them in there, whether it's a special sale or a special dinner that evening. So hopefully we'll get their cash registers ringing a little bit for that evening. We are partnering up with the Rochester Downtown Partnership to bring this event out. So just before the parade, during and afterwards, we're planning a block party, which would just be on 8th Street between Main and Madison. And then hoping to utilize maybe the courthouse itself for an art show, which I understand they did several years back, and then use the parking lot there for some kids' activities, games, and that kind of thing. We're looking at street closures. From about, well, the parade will be from 6:30 to 7:30 or 8 o'clock. From 16th, the parade route will be 16th to Main, and Main straight through town and ending between 6th and 7th. And then we'll encourage pickups to be from City Hall or the Senior Center, so no one's going to be turning right. They'll all be turning left, kind of keeping safe there. For street closures for the block party, we're looking at 1 o'clock. We want to be very show a lot of courtesy to the businesses along there. That would be on Friday, so we're hoping that will give them enough time to notify their customers, and certainly we're not going to run them out. We just don't want to encourage parking after that time in that area. And then the event is scheduled to last till about 11, so we should be able to be out of the downtown area and cleaned up by midnight or so. I'll definitely be talking to Andy Moore and Tom to make sure that we have every safety procedure in place. Definitely want to keep our citizens and our guests safe as possible that weekend. The next day, on July 11th, I will be asking for help from the police department. We're hosting a ducky derby where we'll be dropping hopefully about 1,500 ducks over the spillway and picking them up on the other, where the walk bridge is over by the hospital. So we will need some help having people cross the roadway there. in a safe way. So again, I'll be talking to Andy about that. In past years, the Board of Works has always covered the cost for the porta potties for the Round Barn Festival and the chili cook-off. And it was my understanding that it was just a line item, so I just want to make sure that switching from the Round Barn Festival to this community celebration, that there won't be an issue with that. We will see the Board of Works on Thursday morning to talk to him about that. And it will be less expensive on a good note, because the Round Barn was 2 or 3 days, where this is just a one evening event, so that bill should be cut quite a bit. Any questions for us?
What day is the boat parade?
That would be on July 11th, which would be the day after this event. So July 11th starts off with the Mentone Flying Club having their breakfast out at the airport. And then that ends at 10. We're planning on dumping, doing the Ducky Derby at 11. We're working with Brett out at the Dam Landing to maybe have some kind of a lakeside party in the afternoon there right after the Ducky Derby. And then the boat tour is going to start from 11, it's either 11 to 1 or 11 to 2, and they're going to actually start at the Elks this year. And when they get to that side, because the dam is part of the historical talk that they do, they're going to drop people off at Brett's if everything works out, let them go in and have some refreshments or a drink or something, and then the next boat that comes through 15 minutes later will pick them up and continue on with the tour. So it'll encourage people to get in there, see what he's all about, hopefully help with business there, keep them in that park area. We're actually looking at getting, I think it's called a koozie ball or something. It's like a big hamster ball that you can run on the lake on. We did look at a zip line. We had people requesting that, but the cost is just too much for the chamber to handle. But we thought it'd be neat to zip line across Lake Manitow. So if you have an extra $2,000 you want to put in our pocket, we'd do that, but just too expensive. So we are looking at these human hamster balls. We had a lot of people saying that would be fun. So just giving people a reason to come into Fulton County that weekend, enjoy the lake that we have. The whole purpose of the community celebration is just, you know, you guys know in your positions, we hear all the bad about the area. And I'm sorry, there's a lot of good. So it's time for us to start talking about that and bump the negative out. So when someone says there's nothing to do in Fulton County, you tell them to get out of their jammies and join us that weekend, because if they can't find something fun to do, they're living in the wrong spot, because there's something for every age that weekend. So that's what we're encouraging, really hoping it'll pull people in from outside the area, boost the tourism here, even if it's just for the one weekend. Any questions I can answer? We all on board? Everybody like our ideas?
Sounds good.
Yeah. All right, thank you. I have to come up with $2,000.
That was a big thing. South Bend just had their
Same company. Same company.
That was a huge thing for them. I mean, I'm not sure how much revenue it generated after the fact, but
yeah,
they sold the tickets.
Yeah, there were people standing in line for hours.
I heard. And that's the thing. I did pull some people and asked what they would pay, what the value would be, and most people said, oh, $10, $20. I was really thinking higher than that, but people that would actually do it told me $10 and $20. Well, for me to recoup, even at $20, I'd have to sell a lot of tickets. And, you know, even if it's 10 minutes per time, we couldn't even do it in one day. So unless people were willing to pay $40 or $50, you couldn't even really break even in the time that you would have.
You carry liability.
The company carries liability, and we have to buy, Martin says, we buy insurance policy for every event that we do. So, you know, we always make sure that we're covered.
All right.
Thank you. Okay. you've got stenciled in here for 2016 budget dates.
Yes.
When is the budget due? September.
We have to have all the advertising and everything done by the middle of September, so we would need, I mean, same time frame hasn't changed, so we would be looking at probably either one in July, June, one in July,
We have to have our end approved in our August meeting, don't we?
By the August meeting is what I prefer, so that I'm not crunched for time.
So we haven't even given anything out to the department heads yet, have we?
No.
So when do you plan on giving them the paperwork
when
to start?
When gets back.
Okay, so.
He's actually been talking about it with the guys, so it's, I mean, they've been chatting about wants, needs, and that kind of thing. The Parks Department is meeting this week on their budget, so I should have that one back. And
didn't we do a meeting in June and one in July last year?
Yeah, that's what we did last year. The year before, I think we did them both in July. So it just kind of depends on when your schedule fits. So that's why I wanted to bring it up tonight, so we could try to get everybody on board with their schedules early enough.
Well, July 14th is the second Tuesday of the month. Since that was a council meeting at one time, when we did that this morning.
July 14th.
July 14th, you want to start at 5 or 6?
Well,
Start at 5 worked out pretty well. Is that okay with you, Mark?
Let's just start at 5, and we can do the same thing as always. We can have some pizzas carried in.
I'll ask you, Chase, to go if you have any.
And do you guys want to do that one as your, to have the department heads come in and do their presentation to you that evening?
And then didn't we meet one time?
What day? July 14th?
14th.
For our second meeting.
You mean started the budget? Oh, yeah, we did. Did it at 5, and then we carried it over if we needed more after the regular.
So we can change the council meeting on the 28th of July to 5 o'clock?
Well, the council meeting was still at 6, but the budget here.
We still have to advertise it for an open door.
And that's only if necessary, because there's enough time that we wouldn't even need to schedule that one if it wasn't necessary.
Department heads do a good job. We might be able to just do it all one night and pass it up on council meeting regular. Unless there's any question, we play it by ear. It's pretty much cut in your eye. We don't have so much money to work with, so.
What, you said 14th and 28th?
Yeah, well, we'll figure out by the 20th of July 14th. We're going to meet at 5 o'clock.
Right.
And then at that meeting, we can decide if we're going to need to meet again.
Correct. I would say that way, we don't have to advertise both dates.
Right.
Just decide that night.
Right.
If you guys think you need another date.
Great.
Okay. Got that set. July 14th at 5 o'clock. Okay.
Thank you.
Let's move back into committee reports. Mark McCall, you're on the top here.
Believe it or not, we actually did meet in April. We had one piece of business on the agenda, and it was a reoccurring piece of business from like the last 3 or 4. Don Barker had been in years prior, because he was trying to transfer some land to the conservation club, the gun shooting club. What's the name of it, Andy? Conservation club? Did I have it right? Okay. He was trying to transfer a tract of land, and the issue arose with the state that paperwork hadn't been filed or maintained that a conservation club would be recognized as an actual group in the state's eyes. That took about 3 years for that process to happen. So every year we've been giving him a one-year extension, essentially, on his filing. He came in this year and said it was going to be within 60 days of everything being squared away with the state, so I believe we gave him a six-month extension to take care of that. Aside from that piece of business, we did have our election of officers. Debbie Bartz was named board chair. Mark Kepler was named vice chair, and I was named executive secretary. Which doesn't do a whole lot.
They got Cindy cards on the secretary's desk.
It's pretty official.
Okay.
I'm expecting a gift and everything.
He's a banker, he must pay well.
But we had that meeting in April, and we had no meeting in May.
Thanks, Mark. Any questions? Now we'll move on to Brian Goodman, FEDCO.
FEDCO met May 7th. Reporting a checking account balance of $79,695.29, operating reserve $107,421.51. Rochester Ford Lincoln over here after 7 years, finally got closure from IDEM for the 4th Street property here on the corner there. It was an AutoCAD class set to start at Ivy Tech May 11th, which we're past that now. And on June 4th, it will be a conflict management class. So, Burns, June 4th.
That's it?
Yeah.
It's only half a day, Burns.
There, Dean Foods is looking at replacing their pump system or having the water lines replaced with 6-inch pipes instead of the 4-inch they currently have. American Axle was set to begin production on May 11th. Did they hit that date, Terry? Or?
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, they're still looking for a few employees, but they have most of the ones they need hired. And the county, I'm sure you guys have all heard by now, the county is contemplating a wheel tax. So they'll be holding a public hearing. I believe they've already had the first reading. That's all I have, depending on your questions.
Will the city receive any wheel tax money if that gets enacted?
Yeah.
I believe so.
Yeah.
City prorated.
Yeah, it'll be prorated.
I think it's about $16,000. I just don't want to be surprised with the check, like we were a little bit, then spend it, and then have them come back and tell us we misspent it.
Yeah. I'll look into it if we weren't for sure.
Okay. I think that's what they were advertising the town.
They said on the radio that they were sharing city plans. They met little opposition at the meeting. There was no opposition at the first meeting.
Man, I'm getting calls on it though.
Well, they did. They had some people that showed to ask questions. But that was it. Nobody.
Yeah. Yeah, but they take the heat, but we'll get the money.
Okay. That's what I'll tell them.
Oh, that's what you tell them. Go to the council meeting in the county. I apologize, guys. One more thing. I'm coming back. Team Pride. They had a third option show up that it looks like they're taking advantage of the old Carter lumber building. They may be. I think leasing the main
I'll be at the county council tomorrow morning asking for a declaratory for that property for property tax abatement, and that's in the county.
So
that's still coming, but to a different location.
Right. That's what it looks like. We're going to be on hunt for the $30,000 for the asbestos.
Okay. Thank you, Brian. Any questions? Not. Burns.
Mark, you done?
I'll wait till you get rolling. Back in.
Park board met. That's my report. It's a challenge now. No.
Hurry up, because you're about out of film.
Okay. The pool, water's in the pool, and chemicals that are needed. Bradley is going to be working on the heater and the boiler. They're having a tough time finding lifeguards. They're opening May 30th. Mountain mulch mats have been put in, and they're so heavy it took 5 guys to lift those mats just to put them in. And then they put the mulch on top of that. Now let's see the kids kick that stuff around. Golf. The beach. I better do that first. Beach was noted as the DNR jumped them about the drop-off out there. At the beach, it really goes off fast. Since they put that stone in, the big stones, whatever they call that, and
glacier stone.
Yeah, glacier stone. Yeah. I don't know what they're going to do about that. They need a sign: swim at your own risk, I guess. But it's kind of tough on the little kids. Summer park program. They interviewed 4 people, and they hired. A new director. The 2 girls who ran it last year did not want to come back. Why? There was no. The assistant was Laura Mann, I believe, and they hired Donna Freisinger. It runs from June 18th to June 26th. They're going to start working on the budget this week. Golf contract with Lyle came up, and Lyle still would like to have a 5-year contract instead of a 3-year. I think I told you last time, his parents are moving here in town, and he'd just like to have a little, it's a little security. That's what it amounts to. The season passes are down about $5,000 on the golf course. But the total, when they get right down to it, they're about $3,000 off of what they were last year at this time. And Rod Ulrey has resigned. He was one of the main people out there maintaining the golf course. And they hired, his replacement was due to health reasons that he resigned. And he was in bad health and just prohibited him from continuing out there. They hired Tina Langley to replace, and she knows, she has worked golf course before. I understood in Indianapolis. And so that's going to work out fairly well for them. They got someone, a young lady that knows something about what needs to be done. That's my report. How about that, Marty?
Thank you, Burns. Any questions?
We still have 5 minutes left.
Okay, next, Terry Lee, we had you on here. Do you still want to talk?
Yeah, please. On Redevelopment Commission, thought I'd give you an update real quick. The grant to DNR for the extension of the Nickel Plate Trail from 18th to 9th Street was applied for May the 1st. We had our site visit with DNR last Thursday. There's 3 or 4 pieces of information I've got to get back to them, those guys, before this Thursday, which I should be able to get, and then they'll let us know. Looks like they're going to award 4 out of 14 applicants, so I'll let you know what I know when I know it on that. Safe routes to school, we have our top watch out of 10 or 11 or 12 list of priority projects from our consultant. Not that many, 8 or 10. 8 or 10. Priority projects, we're kind of slicing and dicing that right now before we get together with the committee to sort of confirm the areas that we want to target for safe routes. And then we're also doing a new middle school survey. We felt like we got okay information from middle school, but not great. So we're trying to get middle school parents to complete surveys for us for safe routes to school. And then on the downtown OCRA planning grant, we received that, I think, Friday. So we're moving forward with that as soon as we get the administrative stuff done. Our focus is there going to be housing market, the trade area analysis, a working facade program, a review of the 2014 community investment plan, and help with some targeted applications of some housing and historic redevelopment tax credits, I think, is going to be our emphasis on that planning grant. So I think pulling those three together, or at least those last two, plus the trail, might put us in a good position for a 2016 application for the state STELLAR program. If you guys want to talk about that or think about that or think positively of an application for something like that, we need to start, you know, kind of slicing and dicing our presentation for that, which would be first quarter of 2016. So that's all I know for now on that. So I just want to give you a little bit of an update. Any questions?
How big's the grant that you're looking at for the Safe Routes to School?
Oh, this is just a planning grant. I think it was 80.
75.
75,000. Mm-hmm. I think the city's match was?
20%.
Okay, so 15. The DNR grant, I think the city's match was a loosey-goosey $10,000 in like millings or striping or something like that. The downtown grant was 40,000 with a
20%.
Was it 20? I thought it was $4,000, which we appropriated from Redevelopment Commission already. So.
Well, Well, 20%, I was thinking 20%, but yeah. Or it was either 10, it was either 90, 10.
I think it was 10% of 40. 4,000 sticks in my brain, but it's already appropriated from Redevelopment Commission.
Correct.
Yeah.
I'm trying to keep them all straight is the challenge. Yeah.
Thank you, Terry. Any questions?
So, yeah, you're welcome. Thank you, guys.
Okay. Let's see, we're going down to Mark Smith, Board of Zoning and Council on Aging.
Right, Council on Aging, I'll do first. We met at, actually met at noon today. Mentioned just a couple of things. They held their annual golf tournament on May 16th, and weather cooperated. It rained just a little bit, but not much. But revenues down slightly from last year, but they still netted revenue of $4,756.21. The average trips is trending down a little bit in 2015 over 2014. Not quite sure why that is, but significant drop in trips for the month of April. Last year they did 4,029 trips in April. This year was 3,380 trips. They are going to receive two new minivans here shortly, and they are set to have their audits done in June. The only thing else I would mention with Council on Aging, they are trying to increase the level of participation in their activities, and they are going to go around and visit doctor's offices, dental offices, any place they can think of where seniors, which in this case is anybody over age 55 that's looking for a place to go, looking for people to be around, fun activities. It's a lively building and they have a good time in there. So they are looking for more participants in their activities. And if you haven't been in the building, the repairs, the flooring is done. It's terrific. And they're still working on paint and lighting and the fixtures in the kitchen area. But it's all really coming together very well. So that's Council on Aging. BZA meets tomorrow night. And on that agenda is four items, which is a little unusual. Three of them are variances for garages, either setbacks or height variances. The fourth one, which might be of interest to you, is the folks that are putting the new ice cream stand in out by Casey's. They are asking for a variance to put a food truck in there while their building is going to be constructed. So that is something they're going to ask for tonight. The food truck then would leave after the building is done. But that's the zoning meeting for tomorrow night.
What's Garber going to do?
I'm sorry?
What is Garber going to do?
He's adding on to his building for buses. In the back,
so the on the back side towards the
soccer field. Towards
north. The soccer field?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I couldn't figure that out.
He just needs more room to get the vehicles in.
Right. He does a lot of business. Yeah.
Does all the school buses.
Right. I need
any other questions?
Thank you, Mark. Okay, let's move. Chase Thompson, you got anything on solid waste or animal adoption center?
Solid waste, I was not the person for, but animal shelter, it was. a few things, I guess. Hope it went. We got a few bids for a new van for the shelter. She got a Chevy Ram ProMaster. She got a bid of $25,000. One from Shepherd's, $23,000. $9,450, and then Rice Ford, where she had purchased the other used van that we had now that's actually kind of out of commission, for $21,601. We're still kind of looking at what we want to do there as getting a new vehicle for the shelter. We decided that we had about $100,000 cash available to put towards the new building. We're looking at a capital campaign to bring in more funds for the building. We've decided, I guess we set the building about 4,600 square feet, which the market rate as of right now is between $90 and $125 a square foot, making it like about over $400,000 for the building, the cost of the building. So we're going to look at a lot of options as to how we're going to bring in the money to pay for the building. I think we looked at maybe doing a golf outing, and then we're trying to decide what else to do to raise those funds.
What building is that about, did that change?
4,600 square feet.
What type of building are they going to put up for
400? Really nice.
I guess. They thought about a pole building?
They thought about it, but the architect that we were dealing with didn't want to go that route, I guess. Kind of.
He works on percentage for it.
Well, yeah. So, I mean, we kind of came up with this, the design and everything, so.
It's going to have a foundation that are dug into the poles for a pole building, right?
Yeah.
That's why the architect didn't want to design a pole building. Temporary screen doesn't really last so long.
Yeah.
Not that much.
That's all I have.
Thanks, Chase. Any other questions? Not Tom Butler. You got anything on tree board, EMS, EMA?
Nothing on tree board, nothing on EMA. EMS, the revenues for the month of April were $59,393.73, which was up from last year this time when it was $55,781, so a little bit more in revenue. Calls, billable volume of calls for April, 172. And then calls by base, and their totals don't match up, but at Akron at 38, Kiwanis at 33, and Rochester at 95, and they got from 166. A couple of those might have been transfers and not emergency calls when they go call by base. That concludes my report.
Thank you, Tom. Any questions? Okay, John Garrett, Water Board meeting.
Chair, Water Board meeting. They saw the delinquent list and approved, Marv approved, and second by Doug. RTC has been out planting grass seed on 18th Street water tower. Just right, they say they're waiting for a little rain, and I think they're going to still be waiting the way things have been going. Umball had their financial report. The old business board gave quotes again from the gate. They're putting in the new gate. Gates we originally had put in, that we were, of course, told to put in were the gates that like open out, if you will. Due to what we learned in our first year with snow, that's a real pain in the neck because it opens out and there's no way to clear that snow from behind them. So we're putting in the sliding electric fencing there from Eaton Fencing. And it's going to cost $2,371.40, and that was passed. They've made a, the water department made a bid. Warren was pretty given about they thought they needed a new skid steer by Bobcat, and actually Jimmy and Marvin kind of they just passed it over and Doug, and they decided that they did not need a new skid steer, that what they had was fine and they could get away with it still switching with the Bobcats that the wastewater plant has. The back flush pond was out of compliance after the last test. and we keep an eye on it for the next quarter's test and still see if there's something else they need to do or if there was just a problem they had at one period that it did not pass the testing. And that was really about all of it, folks. Any questions?
Thanks, John. No questions. Okay. Anybody have any unfinished business that we haven't talked about? Andy, do you have anything in the legal department?
Just an update on the Abbott building on Main Street. That was an unsafe building complaint that we filed, and is the first one we've done where there was actually a mortgage on the property. If you think about the interest of mortgage holders, that doesn't happen too often. And there were a couple of other defendants, I think second mortgage and then a lien holder. All three have retained attorneys. All three sought extensions of time to answer, and I received the answer of the final party this morning. And so all initial pleadings are done, and so I will be meeting with Casey to see if we can avoid a lengthy discovery process. I think the mortgage companies, if they have to, I think they're eventually going to say, look, if we have to do the work and charge it against the mortgage, that's probably what they'll end up doing. But they wanted to kind of go through it somewhat methodically, so they answered the complaint. So we'll probably know more a month from now whether that's something we just tee up for a summary judgment, because they're not going to produce any affidavits that are really in dispute, or whether they just go ahead and pursue the work. So that's all I really have.
Thank you, Andy. Any questions on that? Okay. Anybody have any ADA concerns? Okay, so we have ordinance and resolutions. We have another resolutions for a dormant fund for the park board. You want to explain that, Shauna?
Yes, I did this once before. We have a couple of funds that have now been declared as dormant because they haven't been used for more than 10 years and in some cases 20 years. The one for the park bond, that was back in the mid-90s, I believe, when they moved the Garrick Round Barn and expanded the golf course. And there was $3,581.12 left from that bond issue that they never utilized. So what I'd like to do is to declare that fund dormant and transfer that money from the park bond fund over to the non-reverting park capital fund, because that is essentially the same operation. The bond was for capital improvement to the golf course. So that way the park retains that money. It just moves over to a fund that they are actually using. The other resolution, 8-2015, is essentially the same thing. It was the city building renovation fund. Again, our renovations have been completed since 1997 or 98, I believe. So I would like to transfer that $2,069.79 from the city building renovation fund to the rainy day fund, because that is the only option I have for that fund, is to move it to rainy day.
Okay, so I will entertain a motion to read 7-2015 first, the dormant fund for the park board.
I move to read resolution 07-2015 in its entirety.
Second.
All in favor?
Resolution 7-2015, a resolution to transfer dormant fund balance and dissolve dormant fund. Whereas the City of Rochester Common Council finds that the purposes for which the Park Bond Fund was created are no longer in effect, and whereas those funds have been dormant for more than 2 years, and whereas the monies collected into this fund have not been appropriated, and there exists another active fund, namely the Non-Reverting Park Capital Improvement Fund, which has a related purpose. Whereas the State Board of Accounts encourages dormant fund balances to be transferred for efficient money management, now therefore be it resolved that the Common Council of the City of Rochester directs the Clerk Treasurer to Section 1, declare the Park Bond Fund dormant. Section 2, transfer dormant fund balance to active fund. An amount of $3,581.12 from the Park Bond Fund to Non-Reverting Park Capital Improvement Fund. Section 3, that this resolution shall be in full force and effect after its passage.
So it's going into the non-reverting park.
Correct.
Fund, so the park will still retain the money.
Correct, yeah. The only options I have was either the rainy day or with this particular one, I had the opportunity.
The option for the park, so it should stay in the park.
Correct.
Non-reverting park. I'll entertain a motion for the passage of Resolution 7-2015.
So moved.
Second. All in favor for the passage of Resolution 7-2015? 7-0. Okay. I'll entertain a motion for the reading of Resolution 8-2015 for the Dormant Fund for the Facility Building Renovation to revert into the rainy day.
Make a motion for the reading of Resolution 8-2015 in full.
Second.
7-2015.
No. 8. 8. This is 8. Right. We just passed.
We just did 7-2015.
Okay. Do we have
a motion?
Motion?
I second. Tom second.
Okay. All in favor?
Resolution 08-2015, a resolution to transfer dormant fund balance and dissolve dormant fund. Whereas the City of Rochester Common Council finds that the purposes for which the City Building Renovation Fund was created are no longer in effect, and whereas those funds have been dormant for more than 2 years, and whereas the monies collected into this fund have not been appropriated. Whereas the State Board of Accounts encourages dormant fund balances to be transferred for efficient money management, now therefore be it resolved that the Common Council of the City of Rochester directs the Clerk Treasurer to Section 1, declare the City Building Renovation Fund dormant, Section 2, transfer dormant fund balance to the Rainy Day Fund, an amount of $2,069.79 from the City Building Renovation Fund to the Rainy Day Fund, Section 3, that this resolution shall be in full force and effect after its passage.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to pass Resolution 8-2015.
So moved.
Second. All in favor for passage? Okay. Two first and two seconds. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. We have all in favor?
Sorry, it's been moved in second.
Oh. We've already skipped around.
We already did the other one.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hey.
I was right here, Mark.
Okay.
We got first, second. All in favor, adjourn.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for attending.
I gotta go see if my girls.